Hi everyone, and welcome to On the Couch with Scorpion Racewear. Now today, we've got a very special guest. I've known this lady for a while now, and I've really been looking forward to catching up with her. Of course, she's the ambassador for Scorpion Racewear, Ms. Kristin Vermeulen. Good evening.
Hi, how are you?
How are you?
good, how are you?
Good. We haven't been able to have a good old chat for in a while, so this is really good that we can do this as well.
I know, it is really good. It feels like forever.
It has. All right, let's start off with, give us some background on who you are for everyone, and we'll go from there.
Okay, so I am Kristin, and I am 28 years old. I am from New Zealand. I'm from a town called, or a city called Tauranga, and I now live in Melbourne, Australia.
Yeah, so you made the actual move this year, didn't you?
Yeah, I did. So I've been here for about 7 months now. It's been a really good 7 months. But yeah, I thought I'd just kind of make the change. And, you know, coming back and forward here for 4 seasons previous to the season just being, flying back and forward, racing 2 cars and stuff like that, it became pretty hectic. But I think really it proved to me that this is kind of like my second home. So I thought I'd just give it a go and make the move. So yeah, it's been good.
Okay, let's start off. Let's give everyone a background of what you actually done in racing. So where did you start and progress up to where you are today?
Okay, yeah, so I started racing when I was 11 years old. In New Zealand, we've got a class called mini stocks. It's really a kind of a 12 to 16 race class, our junior class. I was lucky enough to start a little bit earlier at what we call black track. So it's not a Speedway New Zealand run track. So I could do a little bit of racing there, and then I was able to move into Speedway New Zealand. And so I raced that until I was 16. Did very well, had a lot of successes. Definitely enjoyed my time in mini stocks, and I absolutely learnt a lot, like I'm sure a lot of junior classes. And then I moved into a class called Super Slopes. So they're kind of similar to a late model in a way. But we've got the big kind of sprint car tyres on the car. You've got to have a certain degree of head on the race engine. I think I was running about a 432 cubic inch Chevy engine in it. It's torsion bar instead of 4-bar like the late model. So yeah, I raced that for probably about 10 years. Had some very good successes in that class as well. Thoroughly enjoyed it, but I was just lucky enough to have Wayne Balk and his wife Denise. Wayne rang up and offered the drive in the late model over here in Australia. And so, yeah, that's kind of we've progressed to the late models, and we've kind of been there ever since. So, yeah.
All right. Let's talk about when you moved from mini stocks and up to the six. There was another car in between the car that you actually did run in the end. That was a little blue Commodore, if I remember correctly. Tell us about that car.
Yeah, so the blue car that I raced was also a black track car. So I was able to race it when I was 14. I shared it with my dad. And it was a good building ground to be able to race Super Sloans. Very similar to the Super Sloan, just went the opposite way around the track. Also had a V8 engine, you know, very similar running gear. So I was able to race that for a couple of seasons as well with Dad before I went into Super Sloans.
So with the Super Sloan, give us a bit of it. Now these things, like I went over, when did we go over? And I think, 19 was it? 2019?
Yeah.
I think once we went over, we told us. But these things, they throw a massive flame of fuel.
Yeah. Like
these things, if you stand next to it within a 2 foot, you're going to get burnt. That's all there is to it. We've done some awesome videos of you when you think.
Yeah.
What fuel did they actually use in those things?
So that was run by methanol. Yeah, it made a very, very decent flame. I've burnt a lot of people's legs here.
Didn't you catch it on fire?
I've had a couple of times that it's caught the wheel, like the tires on fire, and I've blown tires. It was one of those things you kind of had to, if you just had a race, you couldn't really stop and sit there for too long, because if your exhaust was on the wrong angle and it kind of got the tires. But you know, we kind of made a couple of modifications, and you've got to have the like the metal flame guards around your fiberglass, because I've had fiberglass catch on fire. I've had all sorts. So yeah, no, it is one of those things you've got to watch.
Now, let's talk about that still. You were very well known in super stocks, mainly because, I don't want to be thing, but you were female and in a male-dominated class. So how did that get received in the end?
I was pretty well respected by a lot of the guys. It was probably definitely an eye-opener for a lot of people. I think, you know, you have had females that have raced in saloons and a lot of other classes in New Zealand, but super saloons, you know, I kind of came into it and I was the only female for quite a while. You know, it's only in the last kind of couple of seasons that, you know, we've seen the likes of, you know, Caitlin Haywood and Michelle Weimer and all that kind of stuff coming into the super saloon class. So it was just kind of me for quite a while. And so, you know, I kind of had to show that I could be competitive. And I think that definitely gained a lot of respect. I think, you know, at the beginning, it was just more the fact of just keeping out of people's way and just, you know, learning as much as you could, get your head around the class. And as you said, luckily I had the backing from, you know, the other car before. But, you know, I just had to become one of the boys. You know, when you're the only female out there, you just, as soon as you put the helmet on, you don't really want to be treated any differently either. So yeah, I think, you know, in time, I definitely kind of, you know, moved my way up in that.
Yeah, well, it's one of those things where you don't want to be treated differently, but you are, but people look at it as that. And that's the thing, they'll go, she didn't do well because she's a female. But if you do well, she's done well because she's a female. So it's one of those things where you just want to be a driver. And that's the best thing about racing is when that helmet is on, you are just a driver. That's it.
Yeah, exactly. And I think there's a lot of stereotypes that, you know, females, especially in like the motorsport category, you know, you're the kind of the inferior of the two sexes. So yeah, it was definitely one of my things I've always had, like growing up in motorsport, is just to be able to prove myself. And be competitive and kind of be accepted and recognized for doing well, you know, not having the, you know, she fluked in just because she's a girl kind of thing. You know, you actually want to be known because you did well, not because of what sex you are.
Yeah. Well, when we first brought you on board as ambassador, we had a lot of females apply for it. And I actually found you over the internet on an interview. Was my first one, and just the way you presented yourself was very professional, and that's what we wanted. And then we struck up a conversation, and well, history's there as it is. And now, with you obviously living in New Zealand at the time, stood in super saloons, and then coming over and driving the late models, that must have been very tiring for you as well as your mum and dad.
Yeah, it was. It definitely took a lot out of us because there was a couple of seasons that we were racing every 2 weeks. So, you know, you'd be racing one weekend in one country, one weekend in the other country. And, you know, by the time you've gone racing, you catch a plane, you kind of have to reset your head to kind of realize where you are, what car you're working on. And then you race that class and then you kind of do it all over again. So it was a lot of time and energy and money, and, you know, it's kind of been a really, really awesome learning curve. And hey, we just made it work, you know. Yeah, that's the only way you can kind of do it. When you get these kind of opportunities, you don't let them go. But yeah, we just had to make it work.
When I did come over, we went to Bay Park, which is absolutely awesome facility. It's like a big stadium. It's nothing like what we got over here in Australia. Would that be your favourite track with the Super Saloon or not?
I probably had a really love-hate relationship with Bay Park.
That's the Sydney track that you love-hate.
Yeah, it's one of those things, like I took a little while to get my head around it. I did thoroughly enjoy Bay Park, but it's a big track and it's a lot of speed. I think for me, I do probably gravitate to the tracks that have, they're a little bit smaller. They're a little bit more of a skill set. Doesn't matter that you're the man with the biggest engine or the female with the biggest engine, you know, it was all down to skill and maneuvering and all that kind of stuff. So that's probably why I gravitate to the smaller tracks, but I do. Yeah, there is kind of a love-hate relationship with Bay Park.
Now, with you going from saloon to the late model, how did the mindset change from car to car? Was there much of a difference?
I think for me, more than anything, it was the mindset, getting my head around Super slowing is just so, like, you chuck the car, you know, you're kind of kicking the brake in a way and you're throwing it sideways around the corner. You didn't have to do that in the late model, and I think that was the biggest mindset for me, was getting kind of using that consistent speed to kind of, you know, build up on the track instead of kind of you go down and you chuck it sideways. And so I think more than anything, that was the main thing for me to get my head around. You know, I kind of felt like it was lucky when I came over, because the super slalom was second nature. You know, I'd been racing it for so long, but the late model, I did have to take those kind of the hot laps or the time trials or whatever to kind of get myself back into the swing of things. Because when you've been racing something for 10 years, they're still very similar, but those kind of little, you know, those little things that you do while you're driving can either be like a make or break. And I remember one time I was leading one of the races in a late model and brain failure, kicked the brake and nearly spun myself out. Still won the race, but it was just kind of like a little reminder, don't do that. So yeah, that was probably the biggest thing for me that I noticed.
Now, in New Zealand, you've got a very big following in New Zealand. Coming to Australia, racing the late model, not having that backing, did that affect you in any way as well? Because being known and everything like that is quite daunting as it is, but then coming over to Australia and having none of that pressure, did that change things at all?
It was definitely an eye-opener coming over here, because, you know, once you go to a bigger country, you're definitely a little fish in a very big pond. I think I definitely noticed that. But in a way, I think it was nice for me to come over here to start off with and be able to kind of hide in a way, well, not hide, but, you know, not be known, not have the pressure on you to do well. You know, I slipped into racing in the Victorian State Series, racing with a Victorian number. It was V9. I haven't always been New Zealand 12. I liked the fact that I was from New Zealand. It made me different and I'm proud of where I'm from. But it was kind of nice to kind of slip into racing and not have the pressure of, you know, you've had your successes in New Zealand, so you have to be good over here. So I think that's what I really, really appreciated. It was good.
Well, the first time we actually got to actually physically meet as such was down in Alexander in 2018. I brought a young fellow along with me, another person we all know, in Hayden Pascoe. Just going to the country tracks and being at a track where they had actual fires on the outside of the track where people were getting warm while watching racing. It's just a completely different feeling from going from country to from Bay Park.
Definitely. And what I really liked is coming over here, even though I wasn't necessarily known for my motorsport in New Zealand, everyone was so accepting and kind of invited me in, and, you know, that whole Speedway family camaraderie kind of thing. Like, even I was the Kiwi with the funny accent, but, you know, they still really, like, brought me in and, you know, made me feel very welcome, which was nice. And, you know, it's nice going, once you kind of have a couple of seasons behind you and people do start to remember you and do start to notice, and it's nice going to those, like, smaller tracks and stuff, and people want to come and shake your hand and, you know, have a photo with you or remember me last time, you know, you're here last season kind of thing. So, yeah, no, that's been really cool.
The last few seasons, you've definitely improved in the late model. We've all seen that. What's been the biggest turning point from in that? Just, is it just time, or have you found a setup that where you are comfortable with?
I think it's really just been time. For us, we were lucky to have Wayne, during the whole, you know, late model experience, and he's been really good helping us with setups and stuff. But I think for me personally, I just like to be able to get my head around it. I'm one of those people, I don't like just to be the driver. I like to know the whole backing behind it and how everything works and stuff. And I think it was me getting my head around the setups, because, you know, my dad and I definitely work a lot together with setting up the cars and stuff like that. But I think I probably got my head around it a bit quicker than he did. And so it was a lot of pressure for me, like, making the final decisions and, you know, knowing what to do, because in those cars, like, the slightest thing changed so much. So, you know, sometimes I would kind of have, you know, a win in the setup situation, but then sometimes also you just miss it by even, like, the smallest little movement of a bar or, you know, a tire pressure or anything like that, and it would just kind of make or break it. So I think for me, you know, the first couple of seasons were a learning curve, but, you know, yeah, once you kind of get your head around it, it was definitely a lot better.
you do walk around with your little book there, then you're writing all your details and everything in. And it was lovely to watch you when we were down there and seeing you and your dad work together. Now, Willie, like your dad, he does a lot of work and a lot of travelling back and forth because he's still in New Zealand. So he's been coming back and forth. So he's a big part of what your racing is.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, no, definitely. Mum and Dad are my biggest supporters. You know, I definitely wouldn't be doing it without them. But yeah, Dad has been flying back and forth every single time. Mum, not so much just because of her work commitments. She wasn't able to come over. But yeah, it is a lot of time. And as I said, it's a lot of time me and Dad putting our heads together and working stuff out and just being able it's neat to be such a dynamic team between the two of us. You know, as you said, I walk around with my little book and I write absolutely everything down. You know, we've got to have a reference to go back to. We knew what worked and what didn't at different tracks and stuff like that. So definitely that has helped us a lot because I have, you know, 5 seasons of notes and stuff like that. But yeah, no, Dad's good. Dad's got the mechanical background. He's got the racing background. So he gets it, you know, just as well as I do.
Big hi to Karen and Lee, just in case they want. Now,
hi, Dad.
The last 2 seasons with, obviously you came on as ambassador, female ambassador. We've had Pascoe as our male, but we've also been able to design your last 2 seasons cars, which has been absolutely fun. Now, I know how particular you are with everything, and it has to be matchy-matchy as you, I would get texts from everything. So how have the last 2 seasons been received with the cars? Because they've been different. We've tried to do things differently.
Yeah, no, they've been really good. I think everyone's really liked the different concepts that you've been able to design up for us. You know, as you said, I'm quite picky with what I go with. Hang on, you know, they still work so well.
Hang on, can we just stress that? Picky, the word picky. We should
have picky. You know, like OCD kind of,
But that's always good because you know what you want, and I just translate what we come out of it.
No, it has been good, and I think you and I have worked very well together. And like, you know, you kind of stand back and you can sometimes you're walking around the pits and you go, oh, that's a really cool like shirt, who's, and then go, oh, actually that's my team. Like, it's been quite cool. I've seen my shirts, and they definitely, the shirts and all the overalls in the car and stuff like that, everything stands out so well. So yeah, no, it's been really neat. Everything's looked awesome.
One of my favourites was actually the old gridiron shirt that we kind of did for you. That was quite popular, that one for you.
That was very popular. You know, I probably should have ordered more of those. I probably could have sold them tenfold. But yeah, no, they were cool. They were something different. And that's the thing. I think I like to do something different every season. And I think in a way some of my stuff has become a collectible to some people in a way. Like, you know, you've got those diehard fans that I know a girl and she's actually brought nearly everything I've ever brought out. So, you know, it's quite cool to kind of look back and, you know, see what you've made, and you can still see your old stuff walking around the pits and stuff as well. So you go, oh, I remember when I designed that. So yeah, no, it's been really cool. You know, they were a good hit, those shirts.
Yeah. Look, and my first ever design was your car. So, and you actually sent me a die cast of it, which is sitting up on top of my computer area. And I keep looking at it and going, oh, that's just so cool. It's just really cool, that little thing. So I appreciate that. Thank you.
Yeah. No, they're cool. Those die casts are a really neat idea. Unfortunately, I haven't done them for this season, but, you know, it's nice to kind of, for me as well, I've got one of each of my cars. So you kind of look back and you can see what you've done and, you know, how you've improved and how you've changed. And sometimes your tastes changed a little bit as well. So, yeah, no, that's really cool to see. They're an awesome idea, those cars.
All right, let's talk about this season. Now, it's very small season because of the coronavirus, and we all know what's going on with that. So give us a rundown on how this season went.
Yeah, I think the season started off really well. We started off racing, I think our first meeting was in Hamilton. And Warrnambool, and I think I went for about 3 or 4 meetings being on the podium. I got, you know, the top 3 kind of thing. So that was really neat. So we started off well, and, you know, there's a couple of things that kind of went wrong. You know, one time I had a couple of did not finishes at one of our meetings, which kind of, you know, hindered your points and stuff like that. And it's always disappointing when you can't finish a race because, you know, like a mechanical failure kind of thing. But at Speedway, and that's what happens. But yeah, I've thoroughly enjoyed the season. It's been good to get back out there, and it was a shame that everything kind of finished short. I think I wanted kind of, I think we had another three meetings, and I kind of wanted those redemption rounds. But yeah, no, still, it's been good. You know, I thought any kind of racing I love, it's just who I am.
All right, so let's talk about next season. What's happening?
Yeah. So at this stage, we are taking a season off. We have sold my car. Just really down to the fact that my dad's health probably isn't the best. You know, as you said, he is the one that's coming back and forth every single meeting and stuff like that. So he needs another back operation. And to us, it's not overly fair for the one that loves it just as much as I do to kind of go racing without him. So our plan is just to take a season off, reevaluate, restock the funds. And yeah, we'll hopefully be back next season with a car of some sort. I'm not too sure what we're going to do, but yeah, at this stage, that's what's happening.
Okay, I was about to ask the question, what car will you be doing? But is it still, well, it's not going to be a sprint car, that's for sure. That's not what you do.
No, to be honest, I'm one of those people that I would absolutely race anything. anything with engine and four wheels, I'm happy. I don't know.
I'll organise you to come up and you can do the Scorpion Cup in the street stocker. We'll organise that.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Sounds good. I'll be happy with that.
All right. So obviously next season you're going to be sitting on the sideline. The one coming That's a disappointment. We do love watching you race. I do get a chance to watch you as much as I possibly can through their Victorian website, which is really good.
Yeah.
So the thing is, what are you going to be doing, girl?
I don't know. I probably you can't keep me away. I'll probably still be at some racetrack somewhere or trying to steal a drive off someone. I don't know. I'll be trying to do something. But yeah, I don't think you'll ever keep me away from a speedway track. You know, it might be nice. I've been racing for 17 years straight. You know, that's a long time. And it's, from 11 to 28, and that's every season. 6 months a year is kind of always, your motorsport season. So to be honest, I probably will feel a little bit lost, to be honest. I don't probably know. If I'm not at Speedway, I don't know what I'll be doing with myself. But, hey, it's what we've got to do. And I'm happy with that. So, yeah.
Well, that's good then. At least you're honest to say that you need a break. And because of this, I'm going back racing, and that's what your goals are still going to be.
Yeah, exactly. And that's the thing, my dad's health is priority, hands down. So, that's kind of where we're at. And, it just gives us, the season to reevaluate what we want to do and, what we want to do as a family, because I think it will always be a family affair. So, yeah, definitely. It's just, reevaluating. That's what I'm calling it. Dad told me, never, ever call it retirement. You're not retiring. I'm not letting you retire. But it's just, we'll call it reevaluating, really.
Now, someone posted up, on I think it was Instagram the other day, a nice white car. What's that all about?
What white car was that?
I thought I'd seen a Mercedes or something.
That was my friend that I work with. We went to just out of Ballarat to pick up this, he's going to grill me if I get this wrong, but it was a 1985 the SL380 Mercedes. Really cool, two-door, can be a soft top, really lovely, navy kind of blue interior. We went and picked that up.
I actually thought it was yours there when I was...
No, unfortunately not. I was passenger. I said I'd go and keep him company while he had to, because we ended up by having to take the train out there and then tempted to drive the car back. So yeah, that was good. It was a really cool car.
That's good. Now we should probably cut it off at that about here. But obviously this season you're not going to be racing, but you've had an absolutely stellar scene with us. You and I still have to actually sit down and we'll have a discussion after what's happening and everything like that. But we hope that you'll still come back to Scorpion when you do go racing.
Yes, of course. I wouldn't go anywhere else. You know that.
Well, you aren't my other daughter now. I keep saying that to the wife. So,
yeah.
You can't go anywhere. That's it. You're family, so you're in. That's
yeah. Yeah. No, that's good. Sounds good. You're family to me too.
Thank you, Kristin, for coming on tonight. I will get you up here and have a race. I will organise that. That's for sure.
Perfect.
So make sure your licence stays present.
Okay. I'll do that. I can do that. Easy.
All right. Well, thanks again, Kristin. And we'll catch up with you another time.
Perfect. Sounds good. Thank you.
All right. We'll talk to you later. Have a good one.
You too. Bye.
Bye.